Professor Akinola Owolabi. Nice to be back with you on Let's Discuss. Congratulations to Nigerians and Nigerians as Super Falcons won the African Nations Cup, the women version, for the ninth time yesterday, beating South Africa via penalty shootout after 120 minutes of soccer hostilities. Our guest on the program, whom we'll be discussing with today, is one that has seen the in and out of sports, particularly when you talk about football. For six solid years, he was the chairman of FCT Football Association. Not just that, between 2002 and 2007, he worked with Nigeria's underage groups, talking about the teams, that is under 17, under 20, and of course under 23. Not done. Between 2007 and 2015, he was the coordinator of Super Eagles in those period that you can reclassify as semi-golden era of the Super Eagles. That was in 2013 when the Super Eagles won their AFCON. He was also involved at the UEFA level. Emmanuel Atta is our guest. Currently, he is the coordinator, NYSC, National Youth Service Corps, State of Osun. Sir, you're welcome on the program.
Thank you, sir.
How's it been?
Oh, well, we thank God. It's been well. It's been wonderful.
Congratulations to Nigeria. I know you have been extremely happy. The sportsman in you, seeing our women winning the outcome for the ninth time in the history of the competition.
Yeah, it was a great joy for Nigeria. A very beautiful Christmas gift to the country. It was full of tension, suspense. In the end, we won. Congratulations.
Congratulations, Nigerians. Victory, success, always sweet. But when you look at the journey, which we'll look at as far as that competition is concerned, we'll look at how we started meeting South Africa and getting defeated by South Africa. But let me tell viewers, of course, we'll be talking sports for the better part of this program. But towards the tail end, we'll talk about the NYC also, because we cannot bring them here on the program without talking about that. I know so many core members out there want to listen to him say one or two things, of course, parents too, and Nigerians as a whole. Now, let's look at this competition, the African Women Cup of Nations. When you look at the way it started and where it is now, you want to say there have been improvements in the organization, in the performance as a whole?
Yeah, well, in terms of organization by CAF, sponsorship, great improvement.
Okay.
So it was a beautiful tournament that Ghana hosted.
Okay.
About the teams, the one that participated, I was so impressed with the Algeria played. They have shown great improvement in their game. Very impressed with South Africa. In fact, couldn't believe what South Africa played, having watched them in the past.
Okay.
Great improvement. The only disappointment I want to say is Equatorial Guinea. I don't think they were really prepared for this competition. They are rather an embarrassment with the number of goals they conceded. But then coming home to Nigeria, yes, we won the cup, but we could have played better. Yes, in Nigeria, I felt very happy we won that cup. But to be honest with you, South Africa was the better team. Even in the first match, South Africa played better. The final, they played better. We have a lot of work to do.
Okay. We have a lot of work to do. But let's take off from from this scene. We will not, you know who said it. Wombu and Fumbu. So when you look at the Falcons, it's like wombling and fumbling until the final and onto, until the cup was eventually won. So let's start.
I wouldn't agree that really wobble and fumble like the final period.
Okay.
Of, I think 1999. But then they played some great games like against Zambia. But what I'm saying, if you look at the Falcons of Nigeria, the standard there.
And what we are,
what
this
we saw, we expected that we would have gone beyond this level.
Okay.
We are deficient in so many areas. What the defense was against Saliba, our midfield was so non-existent.
And the attack was not acceptable.
The World Cup is a different ballgame.
Okay.
We got to do a lot of work.
The World Cup is a different ballgame. Taking a look at each of the matches, the matches played by the Falcons from South Africa, which we lost to, up to the final, Cameroon, in that the semi-final ended in a shootout as well, penalty shootout, and the final also the same thing. And when you look at the totality of this, if you are to assess the Falcons, the Super Falcons, on the basis of each match played, and you want to situate that with the standard of the team in the past, what exactly will your assessment be?
My assessment, the team of the past is still better than this. We should tell ourselves the truth.
Okay.
The team on ground is aging.
Okay.
And I was discussing with a friend yesterday, even with a top NFL official,
okay,
that we don't have a future team. And it's a big problem. I keep on harping on South Africa. South Africa, very young team, majority of them, the future is very bright for them. Well, their captain Chikwelu has been there for years. He will talk of Odega.
Okay.
Odega was still in great form. Akwara Nazi, because he couldn't cope up with the pace of the game. So many of them are mis- rather unfortunate that we still kept this set of players for years. Our under 20 team wasn't bad. I thought there would have been a transition from under 17 to under 20, and then under 17 and 20 should have found the bulk of our senior team now. You see, most times we are struggling with pace. With pace. The only two players that you can say, yeah, that could match South Africa for their pace, you have an eye shot. You have Ajibade, Rashida, and Odega. A few times that they put the ball behind our defenders, you see we are struggling to catch up with that Satoka and Catalina. So, yeah, I hope something is too late now to say you want to reshuffle the team.
Really? You
know, because within now, let's say for the World Cup in France, just a few months, we need to really work very hard on these players. We need to more work on the tactical aspect of the game, because sometimes our tactics I'm not really impressed with some of the tactics we are really playing.
Okay, you think the problem is with the tactics and the techniques?
We even technically we are deficient in most areas. We play simple ball to control, still raise it up. That is technical deficiency. I want people to watch us. I keep on saying, yeah, I'm proud to be in Nigeria. But keep on looking, look at us at our camp team.
No.
Very technical. You know,
very
technical,
mobile.
Very mobile, tactically sound. You could see what they were playing.
The way they were playing passes.
Playing passes. But at times Nigeria, you see our midfield empty. Look at the time Chikwelu, who is supposed to, that's to a top of age. You know, that midfield. You know, sometimes we lose control, she will be working because you couldn't keep all the pace. Yeah, they said that maybe we played two games, 120 minutes. Yeah, of course, I could take his toll, but there was no excuse. What are the games before that? Maybe you could tell me. Right now, with the standard of Kutelagini, which has scored enough to 20 goals, not just the six or so we scored.
Trust Nigerians.
Yes.
One problem with both of our teams, whether male or female, is this idea of transition of building teams, developmental aspects of the game. You look at the Super Eagles at times, those who have expected to move from one end to the other, from under 17 to 19, 20, 23, and Super Eagles, there are times that you also, or very lately, of course, and you are talking about this one too. Let's look at the developmental aspects of the game of football in Nigeria. Where precisely are we?
Yeah,
are we doing it the way it should be done?
I must say that in the past we weren't really getting it right. All we wanted was to win syndrome. So even coaches, if they don't win their side, in that case they never get overage players. Somebody is 20, 23, you are saying he's under 17, you have children. You know people who are under 17, but I must give kudos to the present NFL board. I think they are doing everything possible to correct this problem of age cheat. Like if you see our current under 17, yeah, when you see them physically, you know that yes, these are under 17 boys, which is good for the country. We should not be thinking of winning. Yeah? Now where we've qualified for the African stage, if they go to the World Cup, oh, well and good. From there we can build up. Like just a few days ago, the under 20 team was there also traveled to Togo for the tournament. 20 players were dropped. Out of those that qualified Nigeria, only for the championship, only 7 were retained, which means the NFL is taking this age program seriously. So they are looking at players that will progress to the senior national team, not to bring players that will just go to a national team, play 1 or 2 years, they can no longer cope up, they disappear from the scene. But I'm happy what is happening with the Super Eagles now. If you look relatively, it's a very young team, which is good for the country.
Okay, we'll come to look at the Super Eagles. Now, the Falcons, the Super Falcons have qualified for the World Cup. And when you look at the team, like you have said, there are lots of work that needs to be done. The other time I was talking about the standard of the game. If the standard is improving, and you now have a team out of how many competition or tournaments winning 9 of the tournaments, does that speak of the growth of the game?
Yes.
At that level,
the
Super Falcons are not performing optimally.
When we say they are not performing, we are looking at not just being local champions.
Okay.
Winning the African Cup, we won it 9 times. We are going to the World Cup. Now, when you talk about the growth of the team, you look at the standard of the other countries, how far they've gone.
In the continent.
Because when you talk of female football, who is South Africa to Nigeria? We were simply lucky. Luck was on our side yesterday. That was it. They played better. So the game has improved. Nobody is waiting for Nigeria again. Nobody is waiting for Nigeria. If we look at our past Falcons, then yesterday, you see, the way they play, the technical aspect of the then Falcons, you know that, yes, this is a team. I'm saying I expected that by now, the Falcons should have moved beyond the level they are. And that's why all these other countries are catching up with us. That's why now South Africa can look at us to the face and hold us for 120 minutes, even after defeating us in the first game. You cannot imagine that, which means we now have to think fast. We have to do something about our female football. We need to encourage female football. We need to get sponsorship. We need to generate people's interest. We need to organize more matches for them, for the female team. Our concentration should not just be with the male senior team.
Okay.
Yeah? Because I think I just know they played fast, which is the only serious international match against France, which we lost 8-0 to France. Okay? Other matches they played were against under 13 boys or so on. So, but this our team, they need matches. Probably there the coach will be able to see all these deficiencies that we'll be able to invite players the way the Super Eagles coach has been giving young players chances. So we play more friendly matches. When these young female players that we have an opportunity to displace this one that's already aging. So they need a lot of support. While we are talking of the technical tackles, but also administratively, we have to support this team. We have to get sponsors. We have to generate interest in the female team if we want to go far. The World Cup is not just to be African champions for 9 solid years, and we go and embarrass ourselves at the world stage. Look at the under-17 that ended. Ghana played so well. I watched it. They unfortunately lost penalty shootout to Mexico in the quarterfinal. Cameroon played well. Even back this Cameroon team in the AFCON. Watch out for them at the World Cup stage.
Okay, now let's look at the three teams that have qualified for the World Cup at the African Women Cup of Nations. AFCON. You assess, let's look at them. Can they hold their own against any team at the World Cup proper?
I vote for South Africa and in Nigeria. But once South Africa played, they are ready to face the world. Nigeria is ready to face the world only if we correct this our shortcomings. We have to really be ready to change our tactics, know what we are doing. I don't want to criticize the coach. Like I talked with a top NFL official yesterday, very top official. He said, "We don't have a coach." I said, "I agree with you." Because I'm not impressed. You could see South Africa variating their tactics, but we are static. It's just when we move, long balls. We cannot spray more than 3, 4 patches.
Accurately.
So we need to work hard with the coaching too. We have to do something about it.
Okay. Let's look at the performance of African teams at the Women World Cup level. You want to say it's been
Not really encouraging. Nigeria have at least given Africa some pride. We've gotten to the quarterfinal at that stage, which is good, but we can go beyond that. Look at country U.S. We believe that U.S. could be dethroned. Today, other countries have dethroned U.S. You have Korea, Mexico, Navajo playing in the under-17 final. So Africa will have to now go to the World Cup and announce our presence. It's not just participation. But the three countries, South Africa, Nigeria, Cameroon. I don't think we will embarrass the continent. Thank you.
What will you be expecting from them at the World Cup level in terms of performance?
I think each of these should be capable of getting to the quarterfinal stage.
Each of the three?
Each of the three.
Including Nigeria?
Including Nigeria. I say Nigeria, we can get it right if all these shortcomings I mentioned are corrected. If we can improve on our midfield, improve on our scoring capability. I mean, it's a coaching job. It's a coaching job. Then if we know that our players are eating, then we have to build on their stamina.
Okay.
Right? Yeah, they have to build up physically. You know, Cameroon played that a very physical game. That we managed to survive there. So we have to do some of this work and this course for long time. Unfortunately, most of our players, maybe 95%, are all foreign based.
They are professionals.
So, but we need to have time to at least bring them together for 2-3 weeks to get things done. But the most important thing is friendly matches.
Okay.
So where you cannot have long camping, through friendly matches, you can correct
some
of these anomalies.
Okay. Now, before we go to other sports, we want to look at the Super Eagles itself. You look at the team and the qualifications for the Nations Cup. You look at the game played, and if you are to assess the performance or performances of the Super Eagles for this year, what will your assessment be?
Fantastic. We should not say we did not go far in the World Cup. relatively young team. Young team for to go to that World stage. Remember, even me personally, at that World Cup stage, my fear was the goalkeeper. 19-year-old boy, no experience. I say, God help us, but we did our best, and to be sincere, that game against Argentina was our game. It is fine because in football, there's politics everywhere. I remember my director general said, "Let God help us against Argentina." I said, "Why, sir?" Say, "Argentina is desperate. If they draw Nigeria, they are out. And the world body will not want Argentina because of their fans, the sponsorship, everything, for them to go out at that stage. So we really need to work very hard to get that game." We got it, but the referee thought better. I was just behind where that incident happened. It was a glaring penalty, but it wasn't awarded. Other teams, something similar happened with other teams, they awarded penalty. So why not Nigeria? So there's politics everywhere. So that's why I say we could have gone beyond the second round. Now remember that we qualified for the World Cup even before the last two matches.
Okay.
The Nations Cup, we have already qualified. After losing our first match, there's progress. And some of the friendly matches we play, we didn't do badly. So I want to say, compared to what happened in 2017 for the Super Eagles, 2018, we should say it's a beautiful year for them.
2018 is a beautiful year for them. You see, what precisely will you say is making 2018 a beautiful year for Super Eagles? Is it the technical crew?
No, yeah, not the administrators.
Okay, okay.
Yes, because like I've been with the Super Eagles for 8 years.
Okay.
There is no administration. Yeah, others are supported. Like Joe Sani, Lulu's time, Megiri, they gave us what we wanted. But then this board of Fini Kamaju went beyond all expectation.
Okay.
I sometimes say, oh, I wish I was still in Super Eagles. They made everything comfortable with them. All their flights, private organized flights, all their money paid them. There was no rancor for the first time. No single player complained that they are owing us. They concentrated. So a very beautiful ground was laid for them to perform. So we must give kudos to the administrators. They did everything possible to make the Super Eagles comfortable and to give Nigerians the desired results. So they might have their critics, but I want to say, to be sincere, those of us that work had opportunity to work in the past with the Federation knows the difference. They have tried, and I hope they keep it up that way. So what we also say is beautiful. Qualifying for the World Cup, not all countries had that opportunity of going.
Okay.
The Nations Cup, we are there already.
Okay.
So what else do we want?
Okay. What else do we want? When you look at the technical crew, let's look at general as the quote-unquote, the technical advisor or chief coach or whatever name you want to give to it. And his pattern, the pattern he introduced as what we used to know of the Super Eagles, the new blood he brought in, he's still bringing them in.
Yeah.
And if you are to assess him also, in terms of his impute, people will tell you life is about impute and output.
Yeah.
It's what you feed in that you get. If you don't plant, you don't reap. Okay? So the general era of what benefit will you say has been in terms of his own personal input and the input of his crew?
Yeah, I think general, he reminds me of my coach, Stephen Keshi.
Okay.
He's doing exactly what Keshi was doing, bringing competition into the team. Looking at a player to his face and saying, "You cannot hold this country to ransom." He brought unity into the team, motivated the team to believe in themselves, to believe that they are all one. The only difference between Genroa and Keshi was that Keshi gave more home-based players opportunity to be in the national team. he had that confidence that they can challenge the foreign based players. That is just the difference. But Guerrero, honestly, he has brought value to the national team. Bringing in new players, he plays you based on your form. If you are not fit, he drops you. Yeah, I remember his interview the other time. They asked him, they gave reasons why he doesn't invite home based players. He felt that maybe some of them might want to do business with them, they're giving players that he needs to be there to see these players himself. So it's not just to say this player is this player is that. So that's why he goes around. He's still shopping for players. And I think he has added value. How will we have known that there's a Samuel Kalu?
Mm-hmm.
How will we know that there's a Chukwueze?
Mm-hmm.
These are fantastic, exciting players that the man has brought into the team. So let me say, Raw has added value to the national team.
To the national team. Yeah. Now, talking about home-based Super Eagles, there's the Chan team would also talk about it in the course of this program. But getting home-based players in our own premiership, in quotes, the local league, into the national team. You look at some other national teams, people in their own local league dominate the team. Talk about the Spanish team, talk about the English team. You look at the bulk of the players are always from their own local league. What precisely is the problem of our local league that I cannot feed the national team efficiently and effectively, that they will compete in such a manner that the way it used to be, even in the days of West Elf, in the day of Kershaw that you have spoken about, that they can compete one-on-one, hold their own against these foreign-based players that we are now happening on always?
Yeah, it's not too far fetched the problem. One, see, let me start by this way. For once, you invite home-based players, coaches, you have to be patient with them. Because when they come, you find out that one, they are technically deficient, tactically deficient. So if you are not patient, you give up and depend on foreign-based players. Because at the national team level, there is no time for you to start teaching a player how to control football. I remember Coach Betty Vokes. Yeah, he too was working on home-based players. He was someone there for some time, but after he could not cope up, he gave up the idea. So the problem now is from our own local coaches. How many of them have taken the pains to go for refresher courses? How many of our local coaches can take his laptop or tab and work on it or see what is happening in the modern football world? You can count them at the tips of your finger. So, and these are the coaches that coach players in our own Premier League. The situation where you come, you start, third player to start running around the field 10 times, that era is past. It is more not about the technical aspect of the play, the tactical aspect of the play. It's not running, or climbing hills. You know, sometimes when I go for certain trainings, or when I see the way they drop, I just shake my head. You go, you see, I won't mention you go to a match, you see a coach giving instruction. As soon as I try to listen, he's not saying anything. He's just shouting. Hey, you see, because they don't have what the knowledge, what you don't have, you can't give.
You can't give.
It's like a professor and a student. Yeah? When you go to class, you teach your students, you tell them what you want. Yeah? But when you grow and you start talking about that, the student will not understand what you're saying. So our coaches, they need to improve themselves. They need to. I know the salary they pay them in their clubs, like, they should sacrifice and at least go for a refresher course 3 months, 6 months abroad. It will add value to them. I know one of my boys, sometimes I tip him to say the best coach in Nigeria, Haruna Usman Lerica. This young boy searched for money and went to Holland stayed there for 3 months to get a coaching certificate. Today is the attachment of the junior national team. Fantastic coach. I'm watching the way he develops players. He's there in Abuja. Sought for his own money, trained himself, and he keeps on the last World Cup. He sponsored himself to the World Cup. As I asked him a question, why he called? He said he wants to come and learn more. Every match he was taking notes, analyzing, doing what it is. These are the type of coaches who want in Nigeria. Unfortunately, this was, they don't have the opportunity to coach a big club. But you see our coaches, big club, with shirt and trousers, stand, nothing. Ask them, what formation are you playing? Then some they will tell you 4-2-4. How do you transition from 4-4-2 to this in case your opponent is making it life difficult for you? They'll be looking at you. I've had calls to interview some coaches. One close called me to interview them. You know, you'll be amazed. Sometimes I will still see them any fantastic side. Let our coaches go for refresher courses. And when they go, they will now impact positively on our players. You can't teach yourself. There's a limit to what you can teach yourself. We have good players in our Premier League, but the problem is the coaching. And no coach at the national team level will have the patience of Keshi, let me say, to start training them. I know when Keshi first brought all home-based players, started with them in 2012, the first team, he removed his cap, threw it on the ground. I don't know what language he was speaking. I think French or so. He went out. I told him, I said, I can't do it. I had to go and meet him, come in there. So simple control. You can't control. What are your coaches doing? Teach you how to control at this level. Make runs, I have to tell you. But later, he calmed down. Do you know that within 2 weeks, these players that could not control became a different set of players. You wonder this from Nigerian League. Angola, if you remember, qualified for the Nations Cup. We did not qualify, 2012. Angola on his way to the Nations Cup asked to play a friendly with Nigeria. So it's a home-based team. In fact, when at the National Stadium Abuja, when I look, I say, coach, run this with embarrass. So, this home base, after just 2 weeks to meet Angola, going to the Nation Cup, it's no problem. When we started, I was just praying that they should not score more than two. But you know, the home was held Angola. But if I let me say, Angola held us to a goalless draw. At the National Stadium, the Angola coach said that it was confirmed Keshi, that Keshi deceived him. They brought foreign based players and so home based. Keshi said there's no single foreign based, they are home based player. So that is what coaching can do. So if Keshi Meso was in place, can change local based players to hold a team, a strong team like Angola, within 2 weeks, why can't our home based coaches impact more? And like I love this coach, he has gone to Plateau United, Makaiba, great coach, intelligent. I work with him, so I know his level. Manu Gawa is another one. Iguavo sponsors himself for refresher courses, always. Same thing with Ikeshi Romo. They're all there.
Okay.
But some of our coaches just call us around, sit down, and say, hey,
I'm one day,
I'm enjoying it. I'm not impacting anything on our players. That's the problem.
How long will it take the Super Eagles to start having a feel of local coach again at the topmost level?
Well,
apart from Keshi, most of the local coaches of the national team have not performed.
Well, let me challenge the local coaches. Improve yourself.
Okay.
Show you can do it through your performance with your club.
Okay.
Win the African Cup.
Okay.
Produce fantastic players. The NFF is watching, and they will definitely invite you to at that level. Simple, because we are, you know, our teams these days, we can, even an unknown team, Lobby could not beat Cameroonian team, defeating Lobby in the preliminary stage of the Champions, African Champions League. It's embarrassing.
It's so embarrassing.
Very embarrassing.
Disgusting.
You know, it's really embarrassing. So we, when they are ready, yeah, I know the NFL will still give them a chance, but we cannot risk our national team. Now, it is a brand. So the coaches should, yes, there are great coaches whom I know can progress to the national team. I know the NFF is watching them.
Okay. Now, let's look at the Chan Eagles. They look arm of the Super Eagles. If you have to assess them too, you want to say yes. And they we have spoken about the standard of our local league.
Yes.
That will also rub off on
of course, on
the level of performance and the standard of the game there. But one would have expected that the coaches at that level will be able to do the magic you said Keshi did, so as to get them set for easy transition to the main national team.
I would say they tried the Chinese group. I can only use the word tried, but where it matters most,
okay,
they disappointed us.
Okay.
Losing 4-1 to Morocco was not unacceptable. To the same Morocco that my own Chan Eagle, which year was that? 2014.
Okay.
Then we met Morocco.
Hello, let's check out this call. Hello? Okay.
We met Morocco in the quarterfinals. Okay. First time we were 3 goals down. Unbelievable. Then it was all over. But after some tactical talk, motivation, we came from behind to hammer Morocco 4-3. So I thought that with that motivation, meeting Morocco in the final, Nigeria revolt, we felt like a pack of cigarettes. But they tried, I can only say they tried, but we could have done better.
Okay. Let's look at other sports. Nigerians seems to be over-concentrating on football. When you look at the performance of the nation at the other sports level, will you say the year has been good for us as a nation? Hello? Okay.
When you say Nigerians were concentrating on football, sometimes I tend to disagree with such a view.
Okay.
Nigeria is a football loving nation.
Okay.
Just like Brazil is their number one game.
Yeah.
It happens, even your family, you have your best child out of 3, 4, 10, whatever the number.
Okay.
Okay. But the issue is not that, I don't know if you mean financially or in terms of supportership.
In terms of support?
Financially.
Yeah.
But the NFF, most of the activities have been sponsored. If you've been going through...
Hello?
Abba.
Abba? Oh, we lost him. Please. Okay.
Okay. Most of the finance is coming to the NFF now is through sponsorship.
Okay.
Well, government, yes, going for major tournaments like the World Cup, government supports. The same thing, government supports other sports too when they are going for tournaments. But they too need to widen their scope, their base for sponsorship.
For sponsorship.
Okay. I was so impressed with the female basketball team. When they got to the quarterfinal at the world stage, no thoughts of for them. They did well. I also the main basketball team. Basketball is really thriving. But I'm not surprised. The chairman is someone I know, Musa Kida, that's my senior in the university there. Yeah.
Okay. Before we have less than 10-15 minutes to go on the program, I want us to take call. Yet I want us to speak on NYSC so that I won't be accused of looking. Hello? Hello?
Good
afternoon, sir.
I want the man to talk about what is happening today about Stavakon.
About?
Stavakon.
Stavakon. He has spoken about it. What precisely do you want?
That we want to let us know what is going to be on the final day.
You are talking about the World Cup? Okay.
Thank you. We've already qualified for the World Cup in France. Now, what we expect from the Federation is to prepare this team adequately. And we need to play more friendly matches. So it's not just going to the World Cup that Nigeria is being represented. But going to the World Cup, who say we cannot lift the female World Cup? It is possible. After all, we got to the quarterfinal during the last World Cup. And we can still do better. So with adequate preparation, let's have hope in the Super Falcons.
Okay, hope in the Super Falcons. If the Super Rebels have not been able to win the
Let them not win for us.
See. Okay, now let's talk about the NYSC. For those who will call, we'll give the last 5 minutes for them to do the calling. Calls are coming, but we must talk about the NYSC. You are in camp.
Yes, we are.
The last for the year.
By the grace of God.
How has it been?
Well, it's been hectic. You know, we just two camps within a space of few days. In fact, let's say we've been in camp for 6 weeks now. Two different streams, 2018 by 6-1, and then 2018 by 6-2. It's been wonderful. God has been absolute control. Can happily tell you the converts have been enjoying themselves. It's been fun for them. And something just been happening there in the camp. Some of them who wanted to relocate came back and said, please sir, we don't want to relocate again, we want to withdraw our form. So okay. Say why? Say they want to remain in Oshun. They are enjoying Oshun. But there was a case of a lady whose mother sick for relocation.
Hello? Hello? Okay. Whose mother sought for relocation?
Sought for relocation. The girl came crying that she's not going anywhere. So we have to speak and we allow her. You know, well, to God be the glory, the NYC orientation camp, State of Oshun, is being referred to as the face of NYC nationwide. We are what that is being projected to the world. And we are not being referred to the face of NYC. You go to our camp, they call it the Europe of NYC, because we put in place so many things. Our clinic can challenge any family healthcare center in the country. We have our clinic, we have our laboratory, we have our pharmacies, all well equipped. And we have drugs that we will not even exhaust.
Hello? Hello? Okay.
And we have drugs that will not be exhausted within the next 3 or 4 camps. And this is where I want to thank our executive governor, His Excellency, Alhaji Ishaka
Ayatollah.
Before being elected, he just escorted the Minister of Health. He brought us drugs, real drugs that we needed, 2 million.
That was before he was elected.
Yes, he just escorted the Minister of Health to come and see our clinic. So he said, I told Minister that we needed drugs. He said a friend was to bring drugs. I didn't know who that friend was. I mean, oh my God, he brought the drugs. We are still using those drugs. In fact, we even had to give some to our sister states.
Okay, hello.
Good evening.
Good evening, what? Can we have you? Lost him, okay.
Yeah, because these are the type of people we want in government. We hope what he has done for us will not be the beginning of putting smiles into MSO Oshun, because we've done a lot on our own. We innovated our camp on our own, built a clinic on our own. We have a bakery, we build it on our own. We don't, the bread we consume in camp, both ones sold in the camp market, are all baked within the camp. The garri we consume are processed within the camp. Right now, as I'm talking to you, we have started construction of a 400 capacity hostel. Why? In view of the ever increasing.
Where are you getting the money from?
The grace of God and from friends.
Okay.
Some of my friends, like for example, the coordinator, the secretary of Super Ego.
Okay.
The time I told him, come and help me renovate one house, I did. Even my friend, too, Mr. Speaker, Dr. Najim, also helped us to renovate the hostel. So we meet individuals. I can just see somebody come and do something for us. Okay. Then my own staff, too, from their meager salary, because they keyed into my own vision. I gave them a different orientation. And they too contributed, and they are happy doing it. In fact, when you come to camp, you see an aura of happiness, aura of joy. I'm happy doing it for the state of Oshun. Okay, but we look forward to government now coming to play his part in that camp. Because let's make it, now we are the best in the country. Now let's make it the best in the world.
Okay. And sustaining possible. What you have presently.
Yes, presently.
Okay. Okay. Now, look at the set of core members that you have in camp. In these last two streams we are talking about, when you look at them and you assess the Nigerian youth, and the saying that youth are the leaders of tomorrow, what hope do you see in them that will make you to say Nigeria's future is secured in these youth, these core members who are leaders of tomorrow?
With NYC, Nigeria's future is secure with these youths. Why? Because I remember the last interview, I said NYC is like a stopgap. Within raw youth brought from the university, from the system, into an enclosure, kept together for 3 weeks. That 3 weeks that they are in that camp, we completely change the orientation. They come in, you know, with different attitude, wild, you see some of them misbehaving. We keep them. Now, if you go on, in fact, their parents are sure when they see their children, will not believe, is it the same boy or girl that was misbehaving, now becoming more responsible? That's what we do during this orientation. We train them to be future leaders. We build in them the spirit of patriotism. We make them to believe in Nigeria. We tell them the country.
Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Hello, you are on live. People are calling, but they are not speaking. Okay.
We let them know that they are the future leaders of this country. They are going to be the senators, the presidents, the Dangotes, the Oyetolas, the Adelikes. They are the ones, the Tinubus. So by the time we inculcate this into them, and when they go to the various communities to serve, we monitor them right from the one till the end of their service. And we have the way we check them. Any of them that goes against our laid down guidelines or policy is duly punished. The punishment is not that we have joy, it's to correct them, to remind them that tomorrow you could be the president of this country. It will interest you to know that President Jonathan served in this association.
Yeah. Hello?
In
Hello?
Yeah.
Good afternoon. Your name?
My name is Anansi Patrick.
Okay, can we have you?
Please, what name? Gaffney, yes,
brother. You want to know the score?
Yes.
Nigeria won via penalty shootout.
4-3.
4-3.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. Okay.
So, a lot of things have been done within these 3 weeks. I know that, of course, there's a military drill. They have to instill discipline to them. So, those of them that are used to waking up, maybe 9 o'clock in their houses, 4 a.m., you're off, and you don't go to bed again until 10 p.m. So you see, all this orientation, every time they come, they become very, very responsible. That is what NYC, and that's what we always say. Anybody that says scrape NYC needs his or her head to be re-examined.
Okay, okay. Now, let's, where next is your...
Hello?
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 Good evening. Hello, you are on live. Hello? Lost. Okay. When next is the next camp holding?
We don't know where. I use all your
American. Yeah, I'm sure you know why I was asking.
Because of elections.
Some are saying there may not be another round of mobilization sometimes in June next year.
Well, the manager of NRC will decide appropriately and direct and inform Nigerians.
Okay. Let's look at the involvement of NYC members in the conduct of elections. Has it been of advantage to the system or otherwise?
I want to sincerely believe me and you know that the involvement of NYC has brought great credibility to the Nigerian electoral system, to Nigerian elections. Before NYC, there were massive cases of rigging, court cases, the endless court cases, so on and so forth. But the government has been ameliorated because these people have been trained that you are apolitical. Even if your dad belongs to APC or PDP or ADP or whatever party, you are as well.
Hello.
Hello.
Good evening.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, good evening.
Hello.
Hello, you are on live. Can we have you?
Yes, sir. Can I know the office of the first to last one?
Again?
First to.
Okay. We couldn't hear you, please.
Can I know the office of first school?
Office of?
Office of first school.
First day,
first day, first day, first day, first day. We can't really pick you. Sorry, maybe you call back. We can't really pick you. I can't really pick you.
No, I can't speak what you said.
Okay.
So, as far as I put it on that uniform, you are political. I will always drum it on there. Our DG countless times because you are just core members on their responsibility as far as elections are concerned. I will tell them the uniform you put is not an immunity to commit any crime. If you do, you hand it to the security agencies. We will not protect you. While your welfare and security is our responsibility, and we take you, we hold them with passion. That's our core members. But we are involved in crime or electoral malpractices. We hassle. Let the law take its course. It's on your own. So we have brought great credibility under great pace. You know, these core members, some of them, they have risked their lives to ensure that Nigerian elections is giving credibility. Forget what people say. I am proud of the performance of the NYC in Nigerian elections. And I'm sure majority of Nigerians will be proud. Those who have lived with us say, no, don't use NYC, they have some hidden agenda. NYC cannot be intimidated. As far as the National Electoral Commission say they need NYC, we will give our patriotic service to them. We will be ready to lay our lives to ensure that Nigeria have a very credible election. We are the Committee of Nations. We have confidence in the country, have belief in the country. And people to the community or the Nigerian citizen too, should not see the NYC as politicians. You know, some of them have that mentality.
Mm-hmm.
They have that mentality that, this was, they are, all of them they are the same thing. That when it comes to election, we don't care who is in power. It's neutral. If you win, you win. If you don't win, you don't win. Doesn't concern. Ours is to conduct the election, hand over to the umpires, and we go our way. So sometimes it pains me when I see some of our leaders will say some certain utterances on becoming of a leader about NYC conduct in the election. It is sad. I will not mention the such parties, but it's very sad. What I ask, do they know they have their own children serving elsewhere? And I always say it, let anybody touch any of my core member, in as much as even attacking, the person will never go free. We will follow the person to the last. Because these are children from everywhere, from different states, different migrants, coming to render selfless service
to the nation.
To the nation. There are some politicians, even before election, will be endangering their life. The NYC has compromised. When I see here, those are throw it away. They have compromised, they have done this. Let them bring their children to come, and most of them have their children abroad. They are endangering other children because you want to win election. By all means, it is sad. It is sad. I will not stay alive to see anybody jeopardize the life of any of my core members in the name of politics.
You have spoken like a leader, and you have spoken out of experiences. Not just for your long years and long service in football administration, spanning decades, or even your experience in NYSC, you have shown your passion and your belief in the Nigerian nation. Mr. Emmanuel Atta, we appreciate you.
Thank you.
And we wish you well.
Thank you.
We wish NYSC well.
Thank you.
We also served.
Yes, of course.
And our children are also served.
They are also serving.
And as long as Nigeria is Nigeria, our own grandchildren and great grandchildren will also serve. Sir, so no fear that NYC will be scrapped.
No, it will not be. That's why I said, we want to scrap it. This is our head to be examined.
So once again, thanks for being with
thank
us.
Thank you. Of course.
It's been one full hour.
Yeah, let me use this opportunity.
Okay.
Though we've done it formally, to congratulate His Excellency, the Executive Governor, on his inauguration. God gave him power. God anointed him. God said he should be there, and that's why he's there. On behalf of the staff, core members, management of the NRC State of Washington, I say congratulations, sir. And we look forward to you impacting positively to the people who elected you. And we in the NRC, we look forward to you putting smiles on our face.
Of course, Governor Wei Gayetola will put smiles on the faces of all Osun indigenous and residents.
Amen.
Once again, thanks for being with us on this program. To our viewers, thanks for being there. It's because you are there that we are here. It's been one full hour. Sorry we couldn't take much calls because we have so many issues to discuss. The sports aspect, the NYC aspect, we can't leave one for the other. We'll be meeting again next week. I'm assuring you, it's going to be another personality in the caliber of international sports administrator and now NYC coordinator in the state of Osun, Mr. Emmanuel Atta. Until then, I'm Akinola Olabi. Saying bye-bye for now.